Harper Audio presents A Matter of Honor, Pearl Harbor, Betrayal, Blame, and a Family's Quest for Justice by Anthony Summers and Robbyn Swan. Read by Malcolm Hillgartner. Author's Note. For Americans in modern times, two events resonate like none other: Pearl Harbor and 9/11. They resonate because of the enormous loss of life involved and because the attacks took place on U.S. territory and were aimed at the heart of the homeland itself. Both events catapulted the United States into war. Pearl Harbor marked the start of a world war that would last 4 years and cost 500,000 Americans their lives. Both events initiated a tsunami of official records, books, academic papers, films, and, in the case of 9/11 especially, seemingly inexhaustible discourse on the internet. As when we were working on our book on 9/11, The Eleventh Day, we have plunged deeply into the facts, and factoids, about Japan's strike on Pearl Harbor. This has included pulling at the multiple strands of conspiracy theory in which the story of the catastrophe has for so long been entangled. They center on the notion that President Roosevelt, or British Prime Minister Churchill, or members of their governments and staffs, had foreknowledge that Japan was going to strike Hawaii. Yet for cynical reasons, some have suggested, it was decided not to warn the commanders there. None of the supposed evidence of treachery that we examined proved solid. We have reported on much of it, usually not in the text, but in the notes. Should readers wish to ask us about a lead they may think we have not explored, they may contact us through our publisher. What we have found during our work is a tragedy replete with human error and lapses, some understandable, some inexcusable, many of them at a high level in Washington. There was a cover-up, a necessity at the time, but there was also blame, unjustly placed. A.S. R.S., September 2016. Prologue. In the evenings when the old man was in his 80s, he liked to sit up playing solitaire. Sometimes, when he wanted company, his daughter-in-law would sit with him, and they would talk a little. She would mostly listen, until he fell asleep. The old man had had no daughters, only sons, and they held each other in great affection. On one such fall night in the 1960s, it was chilly in the Clabbered Ranch House in New England. The old man was sitting at his desk, bundled up in a heavy maroon robe with a thick scarf around his neck. On his head, pulled down low, was the blue knitted sailor's watch cap he liked to wear, for he had been a sailor, at heart, always would be. That night, as he sat with his daughter-in-law, the man wanted to reminisce, to share memories and memorabilia. He pulled out a packet of papers tied together with a ribbon. They were faded and crumbling, some of them dating back to the 19th century. Letters between his grandfather and his father, who had fought in the Civil War. Letters from the two world wars. Letters from the wife he had married 50 years earlier. And letters from his three sons. Earlier, he had entrusted his daughter-in-law with other treasures. Now, as he gave her the letters, he admonished her to keep them safe. Then, settling back in his barrel-shaped chair and pulling out a deck of cards, he talked on. As she listened, the daughter-in-law looked past him, across the desk, at a painting. It was a portrait of a man in his prime, a U.S. Navy officer in full-dress uniform, pristine white, with a high collar. On his chest, the white was broken only by the ribbon denoting his medals. In his lap, the officer held his gold-encrusted hat. On the shoulders, making broad shoulders seem broader, were the epaulets indicating his rank. 4 stars. For the officer in the portrait had once been one of the most senior, most distinguished admirals in the U.S. Navy. Had been, because soon after it was painted, the portrait became an anachronism. Accused of dereliction of duty and errors of judgment, the admiral had been relieved of his command and lost his 4-star rank. In the eyes of millions, it was his personal failure that had led to the deaths of more than 2,400 men and to the injuries of more than 1,000 others. The admiral had borne the lion's share of the blame for one of the greatest military disasters in U.S. history, Pearl Harbor. After his fall, the Admiral had fought on, year after year, to convince the world that he was innocent of the allegations. There had been no fewer than 9 investigations into the debacle that led to his disgrace. The famous and the less famous had testified, some reluctantly, as to what, they claimed, had really happened. Books had been published. Americans had argued. Had others made the Admiral the scapegoat for their blunders? Had the Admiral been the victim of a grotesque official conspiracy, as even he surmised in his less restrained moments? Nothing had been resolved. 2 decades on, beneath the portrait of himself as he had once been, the old man sat talking into the night with his daughter-in-law. Time was running out for him, and he knew it. In the past, when anniversaries of Pearl Harbor came around, he had given press interviews. Eventually, however, he began turning reporters away. "Please don't try to make me talk," he told one of them. "Pearl Harbor is all in the history books. You don't want to see me. I'm dead." The truth of the matter, an intimate said, was that the Admiral still thought about Pearl Harbor every moment of the day. His mind was still sharp, his sense of humor intact. There was bitterness, though, behind his smiles. Bitterness over the injustice he believed had been done to him. Bitterness toward one man in particular, a man he had thought was his friend. A letter he had not given to his daughter-in-law, one he never mailed, would be found in a desk drawer when death did finally claim the Admiral. In it, he told the former friend, the man who had been chief of naval operations at the time of Pearl Harbor, that he had betrayed the officers and men of the fleet by not giving them a fighting chance for their lives. "May God forgive you for what you have done to me, for I never will." The Admiral's 3 sons had all served in the U.S. Navy in World War II. One, a submarine skipper, had been killed in action. The other 2 were to carry on the fight to clear their father's name until and after the millennium. Today, led by 2 grandsons, the family continues the struggle. For them, it is a matter of honor. Part 1. Catastrophe. 1. December 1941. Franklin Roosevelt is president, almost a year into his 3rd term in office. World War II is not yet America's war. Not quite. More than 2 years after Britain and France declared war on Nazi Germany, the United States remains officially neutral. Faced with strong opposition to U.S. involvement, the president has assured the country, "We will not participate in foreign wars. We will not send our army, navy, or air forces to fight in foreign lands outside of the Americas, except in case of attack." The president has nevertheless been tiptoeing toward involvement. When Hitler's armies rolled across Europe, when in 1940 Britain fought off a massive German air bombardment, Roosevelt pulled the political levers to get surplus American war supplies to the British. He has told his countrymen that Britain's struggle with the Nazis is a fight that will live forever in the story of human gallantry. He and British Prime Minister Winston Churchill have for more than 2 years been exchanging secret correspondence. There will eventually be some 2,000 such communications between them. In the messages, Roosevelt addresses Churchill as former naval person, while Churchill calls him POTUS for President of the United States. Former naval person has long since implored POTUS to send an even greater supply of munitions and ships and food. The president has called on Americans to produce more ships, more guns, more planes, not only for export, but for defense of the homeland. The situation, Roosevelt has said, is an emergency as serious as war itself. He has warned of the threat posed by 3 nations that aim at world control: Germany, Mussolini's Italy, and Japan. Tension between Washington and the land of the rising sun, on the increase for years, is now at breaking point. Japan's empire has long been expanding militarily, pushing on deeper into China, seizing strategic islets in the South China Sea, thrusting into Indochina, the future Vietnam. In 1941, it threatens territories controlled by 3 Western nations: the Philippines, a key outpost of U.S. influence in the Western Pacific, the Netherlands East Indies, today's Indonesia, and Britain's Malaya and Singapore. As part of its ongoing effort to restrain Japan, the United States has cut off exports of vital supplies. For several months, the embargo has included oil, a commodity absolutely essential to the Japanese military, a military that now controls the government in Tokyo. Now months of diplomatic shadowboxing appear to be ending. By land and by sea, Japanese forces are on the move. On the night of Saturday, December 6th, President Roosevelt sends a message to his counterpart in Tokyo, Emperor Hirohito, whose title, Showa, means enlightened peace. Together, Roosevelt tells Hirohito, they have a sacred duty to restore traditional amity and prevent further death and destruction. 2. The hour after dawn, Sunday, December 7th, Hawaii. The waters of Pearl Harbor, from its narrow entrance to its inner reaches, are warming in the early sunlight. The sound of church bells drifts across from nearby Honolulu. At 7:54 a.m., perched high on a water tank at the Navy Yard, sailors prepare to raise a blue and white flag, the signal requiring that, in 6 minutes precisely, the Stars and Stripes is to be hoisted. Who sees what first will become lost in the clamor of memory. Bandsmen forming up aboard the battleship USS Nevada spot dots in the sky to the southwest. At the Marine barracks, men changing the guard glance up as a line of planes flying low swoops over the main gate of the Navy Yard. Admiral William Furlong, waiting for the breakfast call on the quarterdeck of the mine lair USS Oglala, watches as a solitary aircraft flies low over an islet in the center of the harbor. Logan Ramsey, a lieutenant commander at the Naval Air Station, possibly sees the same plane. It should not be there, Ramsey thinks, not at the moment of the little ceremony with which the U.S. Navy greets every day of the year. This must be some madcap U.S. pilot, flat-hatting, flying recklessly low, and he attempts to make out the plane's number. He does not see what falls from the aircraft before it pulls up and away. Then he hears an explosion, and suddenly understands. The airplane they have been watching, Ramsey snaps to the duty officer at his side, is Japanese. Then he runs, it is no distance, to the radio room across the hall. He orders an immediate broadcast in plain English, 8 words, that will galvanize the nation. Air raid on Pearl Harbor, X. This is no drill. At virtually the same moment, the reality dawns on others. At the changing of the guard at the Marine barracks, a veteran sergeant tells his commanding officer, "Sir, those are Japanese warplanes." The officer, realizing he is right, orders the bugler to sound the call to arms. Over near the dry dock, a Marine colonel will recall, there is a terrific blast, and flames and smoke shoot hundreds of feet into the air. Men are stumbling out of the barracks, wide-eyed, dazed. Some are dressed. Some are lurching into pants and shorts on the run. 2 or 3 are wrapped in towels. Someone screams, "Get out of the building! Take cover under the trees!" Someone else yells, "Get inside! Get inside! They're gonna strafe!" Bombs whistle to earth. There are thunderous explosions. You can see the morning sunlight glisten on the bombs as they fall, the colonel remembers. Silvery flashes like trout or mackerel jumping. A few stray machine guns begin to bark. A few riflemen aim their pieces skyward and let fly. God knows why. Elsewhere, the atmosphere is surreal. Hastening to his post, a senior officer finds his workplace filled with church music. The Japanese were bombing the hell out of things on the outside, he will recall. And here is this officer's radio launching forth with "Rock of Ages Cleft for Me" and "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." Many mistake the din outside for the noise of a training exercise. Players on golf courses are displeased. "Christ," grouses an admiral, "why doesn't anyone tell me anything around here? I didn't know we'd invited the Russians for fleet maneuvers." One disgruntled golfer exhorts the military to go play its war games elsewhere. Some, though, are not disturbed at all. One army wife will slumber on for hours. In his Honolulu hotel room, Christian Scientist Monitor correspondent Joseph Harsh wakes his wife to tell her sagely, he is a war correspondent, that the racket sounds like a good imitation of an air raid. Then they both doze off again. In his quarters, Admiral Husband Kimmel, Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet, is very much awake.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.